Because the next weekend after that, I'm thinking about really afternoon, that morning, and just remember that next weekend.
I'm thinking way before
we go. Get our Sunday evening service. Thank everyone for coming out tonight, for tuning in on Facebook. We just want to welcome you to our Sunday evening service. So just quick announcements from this morning. Just continue to remember the celebration of life for Sister Susan Carp this coming Saturday at 3 p.m. And we will be having a meal over in the fellowship hall. I know y'all talked about it this morning, so y'all know more about that than I do, but I do know we will be having a meal. That's the part I need to know about. But I'll be here. So all that, like I say, let's continue to keep Pakistan, Danny and Abe, keep them in our prayers. If you can, help out with them. Baptism sign up is out there. We need to, if anybody's wanting to be baptized, we need to sign up so we can know and try to get something planned, because cool weather's headed this way. And right now, that's pretty much all the announcements we do have. Yeah, pastor's appreciation. I'll start announcing that. We'll put that up. That is the 29th. That's Sunday morning. So we'll be fixing a meal here on in the fellowship hall. So I won't say the grounds again. That's October. Yeah. October the 29th, so it'll be last. Now that's usually about when we have it, the last Sunday of the month, so that Sunday morning, so that will be the last Sunday of October. That Friday evening before that afternoon, late evening, early evening, we'll be having the Harvest Festival, so keep that in mind. There'll be more planning to that, but I'm just the announcer. I announce what they tell me. Try to do my best at that. Sometimes get that all messed up. But all in all, that's the things we do know we have coming up. So please just keep everything in prayer and remember all that. So now as we go before the Lord in prayer, let's continue to remember the Clark family at the loss of Sister Susan. Let's keep them in our prayers. The other families here recently that's lost loved ones, let's keep them in prayers. Continue to remember Brother Johnny, Brother Gene, all the other names that's up upon the monitors. Let's keep them in prayer. Gene Kelly, Jeff Hartley's going in for surgery Tuesday 26th. I don't want to say that. I think it's Tuesday.
It is.
It is. Okay. Thanks, sister. So let's keep all them. Keep them in him in your prayers as he's going in. Let's keep all them in prayers. Like I say, all the names on the monitors. Keep them in prayers. Always be in prayer for our nation. And the other nations of the world, whatever thing we see that's going on. Let's keep them in prayer. Our lost loved ones, continue to remember all those. Are there anyone else? Something's come up from this morning.
Let's continue to remember Brother Kasai mentioned Greg yes. Anderson. Let's continue to lift him up in prayer. And also Brother Gene Kelly.
Yes, Brother Gene.
I understand he came home today, but he's looking at maybe going back in later on in the week. I'll follow up with him tomorrow. But let's remember him in prayer.
Yes. Let's keep them in our prayers. Anyone else this morning? I mean, this evening. They got behind already. It must be I fell asleep in the chair. But if there's not anybody up there from my hand, let's all just go for the Lord at this time. Heavenly Father, come before you, Lord, to praise you and honor you. Thank you, Lord, for the blessings you've given each and every one of us. Thank you, Lord, for the healings at times. Thank you, Lord, for the many things that you've done in our lives. So we praise you and honor you and glorify your name, Lord. We ask that you would continue to touch and move. Move upon these requests. The many names that's upon the monitor, Lord. You know each and every name. Those that are sick in body, physically, Lord. Those that may be going through other things in life, Lord, when the economy is difficult. Let me find the spiritual breaks, Lord. Let me meet many needs, Lord. And I ask that you would reach there to touch and minister to those needs. So as we praise you and honor you tonight, Lord, we give you glory for all that you've done in our lives, Lord. So continue to touch, Lord. Reach out to our lost loved ones, wherever they may be, Lord, and go on. Lord, as I lift this nation up and the other nations of the world to you, I ask that you would move upon them, Lord. Move upon these nations, Lord, that they would know and realize that you're the answer, Lord. This world needs to give back to God, Lord. And I ask, Lord, that you would just move upon them in a mighty way. Move upon our leaders, Lord. And I ask, Lord, that you'd look after our souls, Lord. That you'd look after them and keep them safe from harm, Lord. As we praise you tonight as we're gathered in your house, Lord. Upon all these things, Lord. Touch those that's going through the different burdens, whether it's spiritual or whether it's with their God. Just touch and move upon all those requests. All those that's going through the surgeries, Lord. That you may be.
Dreaming and in dreams.
about the Lord a minute. Just lift your hands and praise Him. Oh, just think about Him a minute. Think about what He's done for you. This week, last week, last month, last year. Just think about what He's done. Just praise Him. Just take a moment to praise Him tonight. Just take a moment to praise Him. He inhabits our prayers. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah, Lord, we love You. We praise You tonight, Lord. We give You glory tonight, Lord. Oh, yes, just praise Him tonight, Lord. Just lift Your love. Just think about it.
We love You.
Just think about it. Just inhale.
We love You, Jesus.
Just let Him bless You. Just let Him touch You. Sometimes we fight battles, and that's all we have, is to be able to think back to what God has done, what He's brought you through, how He's carried you through. And if He's done it once, He'll do it again.
Yes, He will.
God will never fail. He's an awesome God. Sometimes you may be going through something tonight. I don't know if anyone's here that's going through something tonight, but if you are, just remember, the Lord's still on the throne.
Yes, He is.
He's still on the throne. He knows what you're facing. He knows what you're going through. And He will see you through it. We just have to hold on. Amen. Sometimes, like the song says, the thread of hope. Sometimes we just have to hang to that last little thread. But as long as we're holding to that thread of faith, God's going to see us through it all.
Amen.
Oh, yes, Lord Jesus. Lee's coming to bring us the word from the Lord. Y'all give him your attention tonight. Thank you.
Hallelujah. Just go ahead and keep praising the Lord for just a minute. Just help yourself. Let God refresh you. Let God renew you tonight. Hallelujah. God, we love you. We praise you, Lord. Hallelujah. Praise your name, Jesus. Hallelujah. Give him the sacrifice of praise. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. God, we love you and we praise you, Lord. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
We want to continue to look at the subject of cleaning up our altar. We've looked at the fact that strife comes into the home, into the relationship, when the altar is in disrepair. Rather than talking of God to God about what we want, we lust and desire to have and kill and go through everything. I found it a unique analogy with Brother Tim's Sunday school lesson. It goes right along with what we talked about. You know, the one thing that was missing between Isaac and Jacob and Joseph and all their tribes was prayer. They never talked to God about any of it. They didn't build their altar and talk to the Lord about it. They had encounters with God. They had dreams. They had angelic visitations. But the question you need to ask yourself is, where is the altar? Hallelujah. I'd like you to turn back with me in your Bibles to Ephesians chapter 4. Ephesians chapter 4, verses 20 to 32. Ephesians 4, 20 to 32. I want to continue to preach on the subject of cleaning up your altar. We looked at the fact that originally God told Abram to build him an altar of wood, or excuse me, Moses to build him an altar of earth, and that it had to be pure, a place where they were to bring their sacrifices, and everywhere that God showed up, they were to build him an altar. And if they used huge stones out of it, it had to be stones that was not hewed with man-made tools. It had to have been naturally shaped, showing us that we need to yield to the Spirit of God and look for what God wants us to do. Amen.
Man.
If you will, stand with me, please, out of respect for the Word of God. Clearing up your altar. Hallelujah. We can try to serve God in the flesh and we'll fail him every time. But when we surrender to the Spirit of God, we'll succeed. Amen. The Word of God says in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 20, "But ye have not so learned Christ." Verse 21. "If so be that ye have heard him and have been taught by him as the truth is in Jesus." Listen to that again. "But ye have not so learned Christ. If so be that ye have heard him and have been taught by him as the truth is in Jesus." Join me in prayer. Heavenly Father, we come before you being a needy people tonight, Lord God. Father, we acknowledge that we couldn't handle the least of your judgment, Lord God. Although we deserve your wrath, we deserve, Lord God, hallelujah, whatever you give us, Lord God, in terms of punishment, because you've been wicked. We've turned away from doing what you wanted us to do, Lord. We have all gone astray at one point in our lives. But Lord, right now, we ask you, Lord God, to touch these vessels of clay that are in your hands and into your sight. Oh God, that you would give us grace and mercy and truth, Lord God, to help us to be your people. Because we cry out to you for healing, Lord. We cry out to you for revival. We cry out to you for restoration of family and home, Lord God, and nation, Lord. We ask you to touch and have your way. Heal those that are sick in their bodies, Lord. I pray, oh God, that you would restore the backslider tonight, that you would save that one that's lost, that you would fill us with the Holy Ghost, and God, help each one of us to repair our altar and to clean our altar and most importantly make use of our altar. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. You may be seated in the house of the Lord tonight. Hallelujah. One of the interesting things we looked at today, if you look at the earlier verses, we touched on some of them. We learned that the sinners don't feel God like we feel God, amen? Their understanding is darkened. When you see somebody, they might even claim to be saved, but yet if they're engaging in works of the flesh, if they're engaging in sinful behavior, understand that the reason why is that their altar is either broken, it's never been built, or it's in discard. It's dirty and it needs to be cleaned up. They can't feel God like the child of God can, the one that's been saved, sanctified, filled with the Holy Ghost, living for the Lord. They can't have that acuteness that Elijah had when he was up on Mount Carmel and the Lord spoke to him and he wrapped a mantle around his face. He humbled himself and wrapped a mantle around his face and he went out and he talked with God. We need to humble ourselves in order to hear the voice of God. How many of you believe that God's still speaking to his people?
Amen.
He speaks to us through his word. He speaks to us through his pastors, his evangelists, his apostles, prophets, teachers. He's still speaking to us. He speaks to us according to the word of God. Anybody comes to you saying anything that contradicts the word of God, you run from it. Hallelujah. You reject it. We want to line up with this book 110%. We want to do what it says do. Now notice what the word of God says here in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 20. Do you realize we don't get it all at one shot? Amen? You don't get saved. Very seldom does somebody get saved, sanctified, or filled with the Holy Ghost, and that's it. That ought to be a source of encouragement to you and to your family members who maybe got saved at one point, but they're not walking with Christ or that backslid right now. Notice what Paul told the people of Ephesus. Ye have not so learned Christ. Hallelujah. He was telling them, you're not like sinners. You have understanding of what it means to feel God. You have understanding of what it means to hear the word of God. You have understanding of what it means to operate in the gifts of the Spirit. Hallelujah. Aren't you thankful for that? Can you just give them praise for a few moments? Hallelujah. Now, notice what it goes on and says here in verse 20. I love this, or verse 21. Notice what it says here. If so be that ye have heard Benny Hinn. If you've heard Oral Roberts. If you heard Pastor Ron, it doesn't say that, does it? If ye have heard him. When Brother Tim's up here teaching, when Brother Johnny's up here teaching, when I'm here, when Tim Hill's here in January, whoever we get up here, beloved, don't look at the man, don't look at the woman that might come. Can you hear him?
Amen.
Hallelujah. Somebody can praise the Lord. I thought the Holy Ghost was right. We need to quit listening to the preacher, worrying about who it is preaching, and listen to the voice of God. One of the best gifts you can have, my wife operates in it really well, is the gift of discernment. She can pick up on the spirit and attitudes of people. But we need to get to where we can hear the voice of God. If you can't hear the voice of Jesus in the preaching, there's something wrong with your altar. You need to spend time when the Bible says that the time is coming and now is that they which worship God will worship him in spirit and in truth. You've got to be able to feel when the Holy Ghost is leading you in worship and operate and respond to that. Notice what it says here. If so be that ye have been heard, if ye have heard him and have been taught by him, as the truth is in Jesus. Who's the teacher? It's the Holy Ghost. What's the Holy Ghost teaching us? How to live for Jesus. He might use your favorite pastor, your favorite teacher, your favorite whatever, but it's the Holy Ghost. That's why, hallelujah, I'm about to bless somebody. That's why even if the preacher falls, the truth remains. Because the preacher was the vessel the Holy Ghost was using. The truth is eternal.
Amen.
Hallelujah. You can give God praise on that one too. I won't charge you anything extra for that. When the pastor falls, when the Christian stumbles and falls, even though they might have blessed you in a mighty big way, and they might have really poured inspiration into you. They might have poured revelation into you, giving you insight, hallelujah. And you just thought the world of that individual, and somewhere they failed in their walk with God. The truth is still the truth. It doesn't change the revelation. Because the Holy Ghost was using them to speak to you and talk to you about Jesus. Hallelujah. Now notice what, again, this kind of goes along with what Paul said in Titus when he said the truth that the grace that appeareth to all men teaches us that denying ungodliness and worldly lusts, we should live soberly and righteously. Look what the Holy Ghost is teaching us. Look at verse 22. That ye, everybody say ye, put off concerning the former conversations, the old man, which is corrupt according to deceitful lust. Now the way we used to teach sanctification in the Pentecostal Holiness Church and the Church of God, we can go on down. Grandma said they used to teach it in the assemblies this way. As you got saved, you went down to the altar, and at some point you got sanctified, and you never sinned anymore. And that is contrary to Scripture. We need to die daily. Paul said, I die daily to the flesh. There is a point in your life where you get saved. You confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord, and you believe in your heart God raised him from the dead. You're baptized in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost. And you believe in your heart that God wants to use you to live for him. But there's got to come a second definite crisis experience in your life where you say, I cannot continue to live in sin anymore. I'm a new creature in Christ Jesus. That's the work of sanctification.
Amen.
And then you go daily dying to yourself. Hallelujah. Sometimes you do good. Sometimes you mess up. But you are putting off the old man. The old man that used to cuss. The old man that got mad at the drop of a hat. The old man that stole. The old man that drank. The old man that cussed. The old man that lied. That old man is a process of death. Some people have already killed a lot of things. Some people are struggling with some stuff. But we let the process have its work. Put off concerning the former conversation, the old man. Notice what it says about the old man. It is corrupt. What corrupts it? Deceitful lust. How many of you have ever wanted a cheeseburger so bad you could hardly stand it, and you ate that cheeseburger and it just didn't help? You still want something else. I know when Alicia was pregnant with the girls, I don't think she had any cravings, but boy, I tore me up some double cheeseburgers. I don't know why. I craved heart. That great double cheeseburger. You remember that?
Oh, yeah. You gave
me away, not yet. Yeah, I get because I was craving them double cheeseburgers. Hallelujah. And they never satisfied me because I wasn't really hungry to begin with. I was just wanting something. See, the way lust works is it tells you, oh, if I just have that, I'll be happy. Oh, if I can just get that, then I'll really be happy. The only way you can be happy is in Jesus. That's why the Bible says that godliness with contentment is great gain. Now notice what it goes on and says here in verse 23. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 23. We're talking about cleaning up our altar. Lust will mess up your altar. The deceitfulness of lust, going after them, will mess up your altar. Now notice what it says here. Where does the cleaning process start? And be renewed in the spirit of your mind. You might sit down there and say, boy, I want the Spirit of God to move in Earl Church of God. It's going to start with people wanting the Spirit of God to move. We got to clean up our mind. That we want God more than we want to watch TV. We want God more than we want to be home. We want God more than we want all of our entertainment and things going on that's going on in the world today. But a lot of people fall out and they miss God because they never died to the lust of the flesh. They genuinely get saved. They're remorseful. They're repentant of their sins. They don't want to sin anymore. But then the devil brings them back in. He don't bring them all in at once. He brings them in gradually, don't he? He gets them mad. He gets them bitter. Something happens at church and it tears them up. Hallelujah. Notice what he goes on and says here. Deceitful lust corrupt us. We got to be renewed in the spirit of our minds. Now notice what it said here. You put off the old man. Now look at verse 24. You put on the new man. Hallelujah. I've heard friends of mine pray for the baptism with the Holy Ghost, and they would get so frustrated, they would quit because they never spoke in tongues. They never speak in tongues, and they would get so frustrated because they say, I'm doing all I know how to do, and I just can't yield to the Holy Spirit. And sometimes you just got to take a step of faith. Hallelujah. When your feelings don't line up with what the Word of God says, you trust the Word of God. And you go with the Word of God. When things aren't operating the way the Word of God says, you line up with the Word of God. And you go with the Word of God regardless. You got to put on the new man. Look at your neighbor and say, put it on. God ain't going to strike you over the head like a lightning bolt. You got to yield to him. You got to yield to the gifts of the Spirit and yield to the fruit of the Spirit. Hallelujah. Now, you can have $1 million suit over there at Parsonage. I could have $1 million suit, and that thing be like Brother Tim's Christmas suit, and it lights up. It can make my coffee. It can do whatever I wanted to, but I still got to put it on for it to be useful. In the same way, we got to put on the Spirit of God in order for our altar to work. In order for us to clean up our altar, we got to keep it simple. With just like Moses had to have an earthen altar, and then if he wanted to do one out of stones, it had to be one that wasn't shaped by man's, because if they put a tool on it, it would have been polluted. In the same way, we got to simply yield to the Spirit of God. Hallelujah. I believe some revelation is coming in here tonight. I believe that there's some people who's going to put on the new man. Now, notice the difference between the old man and the new man. Remember, the old man was corrupt in deceitfulness and lust, right? Now, look at the new man. Put on the new man, which after God is created in righteousness and true holiness. Now, if there's a true holiness, there's a fake holiness. Fake holiness is legalism. It's trying to work your way into heaven to gain God's favor. True holiness is living your life by faith in the Lord, and you're living holy and righteous to be a good witness. And because you want to keep your altar clean and you want to bless the Lord. Hallelujah. It's not to earn salvation. Notice what it says here. Put on the new man, which after God is created in righteousness and true holiness. Look, then Paul gets into a description of what true holiness is. Notice what he goes on and says here in verse 25. Is this all right tonight? Hallelujah. People say, I don't want to go to Africa. I don't want to get saved. I don't want to have to leave. I don't want to be a preacher. I don't want to have, okay, you ain't got to do all that stuff. You can send your money and two missionaries there. You could support pastors with prayer life. There's a lot of things you do. This is what the true man, true holiness is all about. Hallelujah. See if you line up with this. Wherefore, put away lying. We don't have any Christian liars, do we? We talk about serpent saints, but do we have Christian liars? Shouldn't be either one. Then he goes on and says, speak every man truth with his neighbor. That means we are to tell the truth to the Christian and the sinner. For we are members one of another. Jesus said, whatsoever ye done unto the least of these my children, ye done unto me. If you lie to your brother or sister, you're lying to Jesus. It's taking it to another level, ain't it? Hallelujah. Let's go on meddle a little bit. Let's look at, are we really being holy? Are we being holy and renewed in the image of the new man? Are we cleaning up our altars? Look at verse 26. Be ye angry. I can do that pretty good. I can get angry with the best of them. And sin not. It's all right to get mad, but what do you do with your anger when you get mad? And go pray. That's a good thing. Talk to them in a godly way. Work it out. That's a good way. Notice what Paul says here in Ephesians 4:26. Let not the sun go down upon your wrath. So in other words, you shouldn't be angry with what your wife did to you Sunday morning or what your husband did to you Sunday morning. You need to deal with it then. By sundown, you already over it. Oh, hallelujah. That's holiness. How many churches would still be together? How many marriages would still be together if they practiced that? Ooh, that's good preaching. Hallelujah. Verse 27. Neither give place to the devil. Now, how do we know when the devil's showing up? Sometimes we get a dark feeling. Sometimes we get a wait a minute in our spirit. But notice what the devil does. How many of you know? We already hit on one of them. The devil is the father of all lies, right? If I'm tempted to lie, I better be careful. I might be giving place to the devil. If I'm angry and I want to hold on to my anger and I don't want to put it on the altar and get rid of it by sundown, I might be giving place to the devil. So he says we are to let go of our anger. Hallelujah. The Lord hit me with this thought this morning. I don't know if this is for somebody or just for me, but I'm going to share it with y'all tonight. The most dangerous place in the world you can be is not on the edge of a volcano or looking at a tidal wave. The most dangerous place you can be is at the place where you don't care. You don't care what happens to you. You don't care what happens to your family. You don't care what happens to church. Because when you get in that place, that's when the devil comes in. And he can run roughshod over your finances, over your family, over everything. Let's go on to verse 28. This brings holiness to a totally different level, don't it? Look at what it says. Let him that stole steal no more. Wait a minute, you talking about there are Christian thieves in the church? I'll let you work that out among yourselves. We're talking about people that's gotten saved, but they need to die to the flesh. They have habits of taking things that don't belong to them. Notice what Paul says we are supposed to do. Let him that stole steal no more, but rather let him labor, working with his hands, the thing which is good, that he may have to give to him that needeth. So we are to work. There's nothing wrong with having. There's nothing wrong with storing up, but we should always be willing to give and help those that are standing in need. And the Bible says that because sin will abound in the last days, the love of many will wax cold. So here's another place where the devil comes in. You try to do something good for some. I'm preaching to myself. Hallelujah. You try to do good for people and be a blessing to them. And then they take what you give them and then run and do what they want to do. It's easy to make your heart get hard and say, that's it, I quit. I'm not doing any more. But the Bible says that we are to continue in well-doing. To him who knoweth to do good and doeth it not, it is sin. But Lord, they hurt my feelings. To him who knoweth to do good and doeth it not, it is sin. But Lord, everybody else is abandoning you. To him who knoweth to do good and doeth it not, it is sin. That means whatever God's word tells me to do, no matter what anybody else does, I do the word. Oh, hallelujah. Give him praise and glory in this house. Oh, hallelujah. Take that, devil. Hallelujah. Woo, hallelujah. Verse 29. We're talking about holiness, cleaning up your altar. Hallelujah. I dress modestly. I don't watch ungodly movies. I don't go to ungodly places. Praise God. How's your speech? Let no, everybody say no. Corrupt communication proceed out of your mouth. We're talking about lying. We're talking about cussing. We're talking about saying hurtful things. We're talking about gossiping. All of that falls into the category of corrupt communication. Don't let it come out of your mouth. But I'm so glad Paul said that, because some people would never say another word. You can gauge what you say. Notice what he says here. But that which is good to the use of edifying. Hallelujah. Before you say something, Brother Benson used to tell us the three gates that what you say should pass through. Is it kind? Is it necessary? Is it true? There's a lot of things we say. Brother Tim hit on it this morning. He didn't really have to tell his brothers that dream. He could have kept it to himself. Praise God. Some things we need to keep to ourselves. Notice what it says here. But that which is good, that which is beneficial to the use of edifying. What are we supposed to do with our speech? Build them up. Correct them. Build them up. That it may minister grace unto the hearers. Hallelujah. There are some people that have been under my ministry that I believe I've spoken words out of season to them. And I believe I'm going to have to give account to God for that. It might have been in an angry moment. It might have been, you tell whatever you want to put in there. For some reason, I might have just said the wrong thing. I strive not to. But, beloved, we should always strive to minister grace to everyone that hears us. To our family members. There's some things I could say I'm holding back because I want to be in a spirit of grace when I say it. It's the right thing. It needs to be said, but it's got to be said in the right spirit.
Amen.
In a spirit of grace. Hallelujah. We're preaching holiness right now, folks. Hallelujah. Just as much as you want to talk about where to go and what to wear and what to do, this is part of it. This is holiness. Now notice what it goes on and says here. Verse 30. Hallelujah. And grieve not the Holy Spirit of God, whereby ye are sealed unto the day of redemption. Now that's powerful. Have you stopped to think about it, that Jesus, God the Father, Jesus and the Holy Ghost can be grieved by Christians? Paul wrote that to Christians, not to sinners. We can quench Almighty God. The Bible says, quench not the Spirit. When the Spirit's moving on you to speak in tongues, when the Spirit's moving on you to come and pray, when the Spirit's moving on you, don't quench Him, obey Him. Don't hurt Him. How do we hurt the Holy Ghost? Alicia hit on while we were talking about something earlier. She used the old Ray Bolt song, "Does He Still Feel the Nails?" Every time I fail. When we know to do good and doeth it not, we're sinning. When we know we need to say something, when we know they need to hear it and we don't do it, we're sinning. When we know we need to avoid sin and we engage in it, we're messing up. Notice what he goes on and says here. We are not to grieve the Holy Spirit of God, whereby ye are sealed unto the day of redemption. I'm so glad that the Holy Ghost can deal with our mistakes and our shortcomings. He don't give up on us just because we hurt his feelings. Aren't you glad of that? Can you praise his name for a minute? Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord, that he works on us. These are things that grieve the Holy Ghost. These next two verses, then we're going to come and pray. And we're talking about holiness, how to clean up your altar. These are things, I believe, that will stop your prayer life. Let all bitterness. You know that bitterness is the result, it's a leftover of what we're going to look at next. Wrath and anger. And clamor, which is when it gets really loud in the house in an angry way. And evil speaking. It's amazing how Sunday school went right along with the message of the Holy Ghost. I always love that. I think we're describing the patriarchs of Israel and their lifestyle. Let all bitterness, hallelujah, all wrath, anger, clamor, evil speaking be put away from you with all malice. There are people who get mad over politics and they carry that grudge forever. They get mad over scriptural issues and things like that. Paul says we need to put it away. Notice what it goes on and says in verse 32. Talking about holiness, cleaning our altars, making it simple so we can hear God and God can talk to us. And be ye kind one to another. I don't think this church has a problem with that. In the 6 years we've been here, I've seen you bend over backwards to be a blessing to people. You welcome everybody that's come through the doors of this church. Everybody that's been in need, we've tried to meet those needs and do what we can to be a blessing. Sometimes all we can do is pray. Sometimes we can help them out in other ways, but we try to do that. Why are we doing? We're being kind one to another. And this is a good one. Tender-hearted. I was reading in Amos in my Bible reading, and the Bible says that Amos saw a vision from the Lord where God was going to send one type of judgment on Israel. And Amos cried out to God and said, "Oh Lord, don't do that. You know we are weak and we couldn't handle it." And the Lord repented him of the judgment. He showed Amos another vision of what he was going to do. And Amos cried out to the Lord about that. And God repented. Beloved, tenderhearted is just that. You cry out to somebody having a need. And you meet that need if you can. You listen to them. You pray for them. Hallelujah. You mad, you forgive them. And you roll on with it. Notice what it says here. Be kind one to another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, even as God, for Christ's sake, hath forgiven you. I told you at the start of these short series of messages that the problem with the United States of America is not the politician that's in the White House, in the Senate, or in the Congress. The problem with the United States of America today is the shape of the altar. The condition of our prayer lives for the home. And beloved, I'll be honest with you. I believe you can go through the form of having family devotion, having family prayer time, and still have a broke altar. The way it's evidenced is by all the bitterness in the house, by all the anger, the lack of love, and the presence of sin. I'm going to ask the praise team to come back to the instruments and get ready to take us to the throne room of grace. I want to remind you of 3 points that's revealed in these 12 scriptures I shared with you tonight. I want to challenge you to let's come to this altar. And number one, let's die to any carnal desires tonight. How do I know if it's carnal? Does it go against the Word of God? If it goes against the Word of God, it's a carnal desire. You need to crucify it. How do I crucify it? They that are Christ have crucified the flesh with us with the affections and lust thereof by the Spirit of God. Number two, let's ask God to forgive us of any fleshly acts. That's how we're going to cleanse our altars. Ask Him to forgive us. And last but not least, let's yield to the Holy Ghost. I'll be honest with you. My wife can cook, but if I had to choose between eating one of her fabulous meals or seeing her operating in the Holy Ghost, I'd take a move of the Holy Ghost on her anytime. This church can sing. We got some great talent in here. People can play the instruments. People can teach. But I'll be honest with you. Rather than hearing you sing or hearing you teach or hearing the instruments play, I'd rather see you yielded to the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. And I'm going to see as your pastor, us as a congregation, move forward and surrendering to the Holy Ghost. Let's start tonight by cleaning up our altar, dying to carnal desires, asking God to forgive us of fleshly acts, and yielding to the Holy Ghost. Praise team, take us to the throne of praise.